lesson. I'm not going to preach a long time. I do want to share something with you that's been on my heart since I knew we'd be having homecoming. I want you to go to Acts chapter 1, the book of Acts, find chapter 1. And I'm going to let you remain seated, because if you stand up, some of you will just keep going toward the banana pudding, and that wouldn't be a glorifying to the Lord. Acts chapter 1, and I want you to find verse number 20. And I want to read a couple of verses, and then I want to give you the message the Lord's got on my heart. If you're in Acts chapter 1, say amen. Amen. Verse number 20. This is written concerning, you look this way for just a second, concerning the death of Judas. Judas betrayed the Lord. He went out. He took his own life, and he was marked for that. And so in verse number 20, they are replacing Judas. The Bible says, "For it is written in the book of Psalms, let his habitation be desolate, and let no man dwell therein, and his bishopric let another take." That means let somebody else take his place in the ministry. "Wherefore of these men which have companied with us," watch this, "all the time," everybody say that out loud, "all the time that the Lord Jesus went in and out among us, beginning from the baptism of John unto that same day that he was taken from us, must one be ordained to be a witness with us of his resurrection. And they appointed two, Joseph called Barsabbas, who was surnamed Justus, and Matthias. And they prayed and said, Thou, Lord, which knowest the hearts of all men, show whether of these two thou hast chosen, that he may take part of this ministry and apostleship, from which Judas by transgression fell, that he might go to his own place. And they gave forth their lots, and the lot fell upon Matthias, and he was numbered with the 11 apostles." You can look this way. Judas has taken his own life. There were 12 apostles, and now there's only 11. They said, "We need somebody to take Judas' place." And so here are the prerequisites. Here are the qualifications for who is going to be the 12th apostle. Now, how many of you would agree that being an apostle is a pretty big deal? Amen. That is the top of the hierarchy in the New Testament church. He said, "I'd give you some teachers and some preachers and some evangelists and some pastors." And in the book of Acts, they were still operating in the office of the apostle. There was not a greater title in God's economy at that time. So here are the prerequisites for the apostle. It's amazing. They said, "Who has been here since Jesus was baptized, stayed here through the ins and outs, and was there when he resurrected from the grave?" That was the only qualification they were looking for. Is somebody who had been there, glory to God, and was still there. And I want to talk to you for just a few moments about the power of being present. The power of being present. Brother Matthew, they did not say, "Search out the best orator among us and we'll make him an apostle." They didn't say, "Who's got the best singing voice? We'll make him an apostle." They didn't say, "Who's got good people skills and who can manage the money?" But the only thing they were looking for is who has been here from his baptism and who was here when he rose from the grave. Now I want to say something. Isn't it amazing that they only had two names to draw from? Of all of the thousands who had been impacted by the ministry of Christ, there were only two that had been there outside of the disciples from his baptism until his resurrection. Amen. Then it's kind of funny, they said, "Lord, we need a fellow for the job. Now we're going to roll dice and see which one it is." They were basically just letting luck decide it. Some of you did that with your paycheck at the lotto ticket stand the other day when you got off work. It's not a good biblical precedent, by the way. But they said, Lord, we've got two, and we don't know which one it ought to be. So we're going to let you choose. And they cast their lots, and it fell upon Matthias. Now, he is only named in this one place in Scripture. That is the only place you will find him recorded is in Acts chapter 1 and in this text. But I want to say a couple of things about him being present. First of all, we find that he was unseen. He was there through all of their travels, according to the testimony that is written. He was there when Jesus came off the hill and John said, Behold, the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. He was there through the ins and outs. He was there when Lazarus was raised from the grave. He was there when the 5,000 were fed. He was there for all of those miracles, but he was not listed. He was unseen. He remained behind the curtain. He was not highlighted. Nobody knew his name. He was not listed with the 12. But thank God, you do not have to be seen and celebrated in order to be present. Thank God for those people who are willing to stay in the background. And they're never applauded. They're never cheered. They're never recognized. But just like Matthias, you can count on them to be present. You know, he was unseen. And maybe that's what Paul meant in Ephesians 6 when he said that we ought to serve not with eye service as men pleasers, but as the servants of Christ, doing the will of God from the heart. To be unseen, but yet still have a heart of service. Oh, I say to you that it was Matthias that was there when they were passing out the broken fish and loaves to the thousands on the hillside. No doubt it was Matthias that was there as they traveled from city to city. It was Matthias who was present in the garden when they came to take him and arrest him. But for all that he did in service, it appeared as though it was unseen. I thought about his unseen service, but I thought about his unseen struggles. You know, we have a pretty good record of Thomas' struggles. We have a pretty clear record of Simon Peter's struggles. We even have a good record of John's struggles and those other disciples, but nobody wrote anything down about the struggles of Matthias. But oh, I'm glad that I can say confidently today that though you may feel as no one sees your struggle, you may feel as though no one sees your service. Child of God, know this, when you are present, you may be unseen by others, but God keeps a good record book in heaven. This church is here today not because so much of what's happened behind the pulpit, but because of the unseen presence of those that have been faithful in these pews. Those that have given when they didn't have anything to give. Those that have prayed when they needed prayers for themselves. And I stand this morning keenly aware that it is often the unseen that make the biggest impact on what is visible. Matthias was unseen, but then I like this, he was unshaken. I love that portion of the verse where they said, find somebody, verse 21, who was with us all the time that the Lord Jesus went in and out among us. That's an interesting phrase, that he went in and out among us. Oh, I need somebody to be honest and help me right here. There are times in life when we know that he is in the house and among us. And then there are seasons of life where he goes out from among us. We look around and wonder, where is he? What's he doing? When will he be back? And I like it when he's in. Oh, when he's in, the presence of God is so real you can almost touch it. When he's in, prayers are answered almost before you even pray them. When he's in, you can preach with the anointing of God. Sometimes I get behind this pulpit and it's like going down a hill on roller skates. I mean, I don't even know what I'm going to say next. And I like like it when he's in. Amen. But oh, there are those times when he's out. And there are those times where the heavens feel like they're made out of brass. We pray prayers and they seem not even make it through the sheetrock. And we try to worship and it seems like our hands are extra heavy. We try to preach and the roller skates fall off and the heel gets going the other direction and we can't even make sense out of John 3:16. I've been there before. But God's looking for somebody like Matthias who will be faithful when Jesus is in season and when Jesus seems to be out of season. How easy would it have been to walk away in those out seasons in the ministry of Christ? The Bible said that many walked away in John 6, verse 66. They forsook him. Even the disciples themselves had moments of relapse. You know, there's a verse where Simon Peter said, "Lord, to whom shall we go?" And that sounds so spiritual. But if you hang on a few chapters, Simon Peter found somewhere to go. He went back to the fishing industry. He went back to a boat and a fisherman's coat that he had in reserve. There are those out seasons where it's hard to figure out what God's doing. But thank God for those that are present, not only when it's good, but when it's bad. Not only when it's blessed, but when it's a burden. And I want to say thank God. I have people ask me all the time, "How in the world do you stay at the church, the same church, 18 years? Here's the answer. You just don't leave. Hey, it's not been 18 years of revival. It's not been 18 years of blessing. It's not been 18 years of mountaintops and overcoming. There's been some valleys. There's been some low places. There's been some heartaches. But thank God, you just keep on keeping on and you stay present in the ins and the outs. And I want to say thank God for some people around here who have just stayed faithful through the ins and the outs. Brother Terry Hutchison sitting on that stairwell back there, one of the greatest servants that God has ever brought to Greater Life Baptist Church. Stood by his preacher, stood with his preacher, stood for his preacher, and even today is a vital part in what God's doing here. Brother J.C. Cross rolled up on this property some 13, 14 years ago. His babies were just brand new born. We were still dedicating them. And he hooked up to this place. And thank God, through the ins and the outs, still present day after day. Some of the greatest men in this church didn't come here as men. They came here as teenagers. They came here as boys looking for girls. Spencer, say amen right there. And I have had the distinct honor of watching boys in this church become some of the greatest men that I've ever known in my life. Men of character, men of integrity, men who will stand when it's not popular. And you don't get there unless you are present in and out. I'm enjoying my own preaching this morning. Hallelujah. I may buy this CD. Hallelujah. Maybe I'll get a pastoral discount or something on it. They're unshaken. They're unseen. But last one. You know something about Matthias? He was undeniable. You know what they said? We got to have somebody who was here and was a witness. Now listen, Matthias never wrote a book in the Bible. We don't have a record of any miracle. But you know what Matthias could say? I was there. Amen. Somebody would say, you know, I just don't believe that he really raised Lazarus from the dead. Matthias would say, I was there. I just don't know if he really fed 5,000. Matthias pulled the hay out of his mouth. Yeah, I was there. You mean to tell me that he really rose from the grave, Matthias? Yep, because I was there. There is a great confidence that comes in being present to the point that you know what you know because you have experienced it for yourself. Some of you this morning are shouting on credit because you've not stuck with it long enough to see the faithfulness of God. But oh, while they were singing, "There's a roof up above me, I've got food on my table, and I've got shoes on my feet." I look back to the second row, and my precious mama, who's been serving the Lord now some 47, 52 years, was weeping with tears streaming down her face. You know how she knows? Because she has an undeniable track record with Him, and He has been faithful. But see, if you want to come one Sunday and miss four and show up one Sunday and lay out three, I mean, you can come and we want you to hook up and worship when you get here, but there's just some things you're not going to know for yourself. But thank God, like that insurance commercial, we know some things because we've seen some things. And I'm not telling you something this morning that I read in a theology textbook. I'm not telling you something that I heard another preacher say. I'm not telling you what they taught me in college. I'm telling you like Matthias, I have watched him. I have been there. I have seen it for myself. And I know that I know that I know that He is all and more than He says He is. I wrote this little statement down. A man with experience is never at the mercy of a man with an argument. A man with experience is never at the mercy of a man with an argument, because I know for myself what I have seen with my own eyes. There's power in being present. Sometimes we may feel like Matthias, never really worked any miracles. You know, never really done anything to get showcased or highlighted. But at the end of our life, you know what it would be worth just to say, I was there. I was there. I was present. I never quit. I never dropped out. I never walked away. I was present. And in the ministry and in the power of being present, you can build an undeniable faith. And by the way, when God comes by with promotion, the first thing He's going to do is see who